eyes and let me see. Always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold. Not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use.
Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's doing well. I hope that we're not still in a food coma from this past week, this past weekend. I'm excited about today because I get to do the pre-Christmas sermon. And that's how I'm building it up, because you'll see why here in a minute. But let me first ask a question, I guess, to get everything started. Don't we love our plans? Our plans that we make, the control that we think that we have sometimes. Now we all do it. Now some of y'all might think that, no, I don't do plans, I don't do that kind of stuff. Yeah, you actually do. We all do it in some kind. Maybe not as detailed as other people, but we all do it in some way, some fashion. Take this weekend, for example, Thanksgiving weekend. I mean, all kinds of plans, all kinds of things going on at one time. Seems like so many things are going on. Do you realize that Thanksgiving is one of the most planned holidays in our nation? Except for one that is coming at us at a high rate of speed, Christmas. Christmas is the only other one that beats it out. But we all had our plans of some sort this past week due to all the holidays, due to traveling, due to all the different things that was going on. The Marsh household, no exception to this at all. We had plans. We had very well laid out plans for this past weekend. Because not only is it Thanksgiving, but it's also Benjamin's birthday. So everything's supposed to come together, right? You have, first of all, guys, the wife or Heather has the list, right? The list that has to be done before everybody comes over. You know what I'm talking about. Things that have to be moved, things that have to be just done before people come over. You know what I'm talking about. And yeah, they were pretty much all done at our house, except for the fact that me and Blake took a excursion the weekend right before. So it took out some of my time, but we still got the stuff done. And then there's, of course, after all the pre stuff is done, now you have to worry about the guest list, all the different people that are coming. We went above and beyond this year, just because we haven't gotten together in a while as a whole family with my side and Heather's side. We planned on all of them to come together. What were we thinking, right? Putting that many people, that many minds together like that, right? And then not only that, but the food. You know, that's one of the important things, right? The food. And not only the certain foods that you like and this and that and the other, but here's the other thing. They all have to be ready at the same time, right? So everything's warm. There's planning that has to be done for all this to happen. And then let's not forget the other most important thing, at least for our household on Thanksgiving, football. We got to, okay, so we're eating, so when the first game comes on, and then second game comes on is when you're hitting the seconds, and then desserts and everything, by now three games on Thanksgiving Day. So all that's sounding really good so far, right? The plans are coming together, everything's working out, but then it happens. Like I said, you thought you were in control, but see, what we didn't realize is Heather's side of the family, just about all of them got sick and they couldn't come. Randy on her side was the only one that has actually come. So here's our dilemma. Blake bought the turkey this year, 25-pound turkey. That's a lot of turkey. That's a lot of turkey. And then not only that, we always do turkey and ham, so we bought a really big ham. So we have all this. And then, you know, we don't make little dishes of anything. When we do Thanksgiving, we buy the big dishes and make, you have all these different casseroles. You have all this other stuff. So we had abundance of food. I was like, nah, y'all ain't leaving without extras. So what did I went down to Dollar General and I bought all the Rubbermaid to-go place they had, so I can make sure everybody leaves out with a couple meals in hand, because I was not putting all that food back in my refrigerator. So you know, how about your stories, though? I mean, we all have our stories of how our plans or how we thought we were in control, you know, would just fall apart. We all had those crazy family stories. And I could sit here and I could tell you Thanksgiving after Thanksgiving some of the things that have happened in our house. And I love every moment of it, but it proves that our plans doesn't always work out. We find out, you know, the family dynamic, you know. Family's a wonderful thing sometimes, isn't it? And I'll leave it at that. You know, but here's the bad news, because there's bad news to all this planning. Thanksgiving's over, but now Christmas is on the way. There's your bad news, because now, see, not only was Thanksgiving pressure for you, think about Christmas. The stakes are higher, right? The goals are higher. The expectations are much higher. But no pressure, right? Absolutely, we love our plans. I told you, we all make plans in some way. You might think that you don't. You might think that you just live freely and you just do it as you go along. No, that's not the case. You make plans, whether you like it or not, you do. And I'm sure most of us had our plans, whether they worked out or not. I'm not sure about that. But we love those plans. We love that control thing. We love control. We really do. The more control we feel like we have, the better off we feel sometimes. Because we think that we have that control thing in our back pocket and it's ours and it's how I do things. So why do we love it so much? Why do we love control? Why do we love that planning so much? The answer is actually really simple. We think control guarantees us the life that we want. Isn't that true sometimes, though? We think that control that we have, those plans that we make, that absolutely guarantees the life that we want. We try to control because we're trying to guarantee the outcomes that we think we need, even. That's why we love our control, whether you admit it or not. That's why we love it so much, because we think that's going to satisfy everything. So today we're going to actually take our plans. We're going to take our control that we think we have, and we're going to actually weigh them against the plans that God has for us. And that's the example that we're going to be looking at. We're going to be in Luke chapter 1 as we start out today. And we're going to enlist the help of Luke this morning, because in this very first chapter we find Luke giving an awesome description of a man that thought he had his plans. He thought he had his control, and he thought that everything was good. There was no complaints, and then it happens. Things change. His plans are altered as we look today, but as we also see today, God's plans are moving, and they're moving forward and moving us closer and closer to Jesus. Our story, our scripture this morning is going to be in Luke chapter 1, verses 5 through 22. And I know this is a lot of scripture, but I believe that we have to read it all to understand actually what's going on this morning. So if you will, Luke chapter 1, it's up on the screen as well, verses 5 through 22. In the time of Herod, king of Judah, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all of the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of priesthood, to go to the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of the incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. And then here's when it happens. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of the incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is to never take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit of power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." Then the angel said to him, "I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to you, speak to you, and to tell you the good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." And then meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak to them. Then he realized he had seen the vision. Then they had realized he had seen the vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. Now, as we look at this scripture, now, if you are not a Christian this morning, if you haven't accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, some of these words this morning is very religious talk, I guess you could say. It's a lot of religious stuff going on at one time. It's a lot of Jewish content is what I'm trying to say. Not so much Christian content, but what it's leading to is actually Jesus. And you'll see how that's tied in by the time we get to the end this morning, so hang on for that. But as we set up this text with the content this morning, we need to start off with just a few facts about Zechariah. Who is he? So we can actually better understand where he's coming from. This is the father of John the Baptist, if you haven't realized that yet. When the angel said, "You'll name him John," this is John the Baptist. This is the man, the forerunner of Christ. And although this guy never actually shows up in our beloved nativity scenes, Zechariah is probably one of the most important figures in Christ's birth. Think about it. Luke's account here, he doesn't start with the birth of Jesus. He starts with the birth of John the Baptist because he's the forerunner, right? So it's an important fact that Luke writes down this account, and that it starts out with Zechariah. Now Zechariah is actually one of the first people in the New Testament that actually speaks with an angel, if you look at it chronologically. Most of the stories, if you think about the Jesus birth, and you'll be hearing a lot of them as we go through the Christmas season, most of the time we think of Mary and Joseph being the only ones that ever actually had a conversation with an angel. But that's how Luke actually kicks off the story here. That's how he kicks off the story about Jesus, is the conversation that an angel is having with Zechariah about John. Which they're relatives, which makes, that's a whole nother sermon series all in itself. They're related in a way. But Zechariah, why is Zechariah so important here? Well, he's actually a priest they're actually responsible for the sacrifices and taking care of the temple work. All the different stuff that goes on in the temple, that's what the priests were there doing. One of their duties, as we see this morning, is the incense, the burning of the incense, to make sure that they're burning at all time. And Zechariah is that's what he's doing right now when the angel comes to him. And as we continue to look at the scripture today, we're going to see and learn that this man thought that life was all planned out. As Luke first starts, his life is good. His plans are not bad plans. He's living a good life right now. But that's our dilemma as we look further today, because it's my plans. It's my control versus God's plans for me. And like I said, that's not always that our plans are bad, but are they always the best? Is it always what God has in store for us? And as we look at God's plans today, we see than pointing actually to a greater plan, a greater purpose. And it just doesn't end with John Baptist. And that's one of the mistakes that we make all too often is we get focused on that one thing because we think that's the most important, even when it's given to us by God. But sometimes we don't look past that because the story of John the Baptist doesn't end with John the Baptist. It goes further. It's still living today through Christ. Every time someone accepts Jesus as their Lord and Savior, the story continues. It's an never-ending story that started right here with Zechariah. That's us living an ordinary life, or what we think that is an ordinary life, and God making something extraordinary out of it by us just stopping, listening, trusting. Right? If you don't get anything else this morning, we might have to give up our plans. Sometimes we might have to give up our plans, our blessed control, that control that we have in our back pocket. Sometimes we have to give up those things to let God have His way in our lives. Sometimes we have to give our plans up, our so-called control that we think that we have. That's the picture that I have up on the screen this morning. I usually don't even acknowledge my title screen, but this morning, you see the strings. That's you controlling your life. That's what that's you trying to control your life. That's you and your plans, and you're sitting there trying. But guys, I'll be the first to admit to you this morning, if you're trying to control your life that way, those strings are going to get tangled up. They will, I promise you. That's why I said what I said. Sometimes you have to stop. Sometimes you have to listen. Sometimes you have to trust. Trust God and His plans. As we start to open the text up this morning, we're going to look at it in a way that will force us. It's actually going to force us to make a choice. Is it going to be my way, or is it going to be the way of God? And that's a tough choice to make sometimes because, like I said, we like that control. We like those plans. And sometimes it's really hard to let that stuff go. But hopefully, as we look at today, maybe it'll loosen up a little bit for you this morning. The first thing that we need to look at, first things first, and I had to say that because, unfortunately, we do get in the way. We get in the way all the time of God's plans because we think our plan is the best plan. It's what I'm used to. It's what I'm comfortable with. Because that's what it comes down to a lot of times with our planning and our control. It's what we're comfortable with. It's my cozy blanket that I get to pull over me, right? That's what that is sometimes, because when we have to step away from that, it gets a little uncomfortable sometimes. And that's where we see in the first, I guess if you were to look at the verses 5 through 12, you'd see that this is where Zechariah is comfortable. This is what he's comfortable with. And if as we look at that scripture, we see Zechariah you might not think of it, but he's being very set in his ways. And you'll see that by the way that he responds to the angel here in a moment. But nothing's wrong with what he's doing here. He's a priest. He's working in the temple. He's doing God's work. He's doing some really good stuff. But God has other plans, right? We see that he has his house. His house is squared away. His family is squared away. We see that in verse 6. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. Both of them. That's him and Elizabeth. They're doing what they're supposed to do. They're righteous in the eyes of God. His house is squared away, right? Absolutely. This is the life they have chosen. This is the life that they're living, and they're good. They're comfortable. This is, and it's not a bad life. And then if you look down into verse 8, we see that his job, what he does, he has his job squared away. So he has his house squared away. Now he has his job squared away. In verse 8, when Zechariah's division was on duty, he was serving as priest before God. And then verse 9, he was chosen by lot according to the custom of priesthood to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. Now, one thing that that you got to realize here. Zechariah, he is not a first generation priest in his home. His dad was a priest. His grandfather was a priest. Actually, even Elizabeth's side of the family, they're a priest. So guess what Zechariah is? He's a priest. This is what I'm comfortable with. It's always been part of my family. This is what I do. This is the path that I am on. It's where we are. His house, his job is squared away. God seems to even bless this because think about it, that they drew lots for him to go in and to do this. The lots fell in his way. They did this. And now think about this. There were so many priests that they were divided. Like I said, we saw that his division was up next. So the priests were divided in divisions to take care of all the temple work. And so there was that many priests that some priests would never even be called to do this. That's how many was there. So he's being blessed. His job is being blessed because now he gets to walk into the temple. My plans are working. I'm in control. I love that because who blessed him? God. God has other plans, and he's getting ready to find out why his lot came up and he was walking into the temple. We're getting ready to see that. And besides all of this, now here's the part that a lot of us falls into with our comfort level of our control and our plans. They are both old and no worries of children. In verse 7, but they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. I'm set in my ways. That right there is what Zechariah is saying. I'm good. I'm set in my ways. I don't need a change. Nothing needs to happen. My house is squared away. My job's squared away. I'm good. They had their set of plans right in front of them. They had control over their lives. Everything's good. No need to change anything. Let's be honest this morning. We all had that mindset in some way, some form. We have that at one point or another. Again, it's not that our plans are bad. It's not that we're living a sinful life, but we're just comfortable. I'm comfortable doing what I'm doing. My house is taken care of. My job is taken care of. I'm on my path. I'm good. And that's where a lot of times our mindset is, because it's human nature. Let's be honest about that. I once thought I was in control. I had my own plans though. And Heather knows this. I was never going to get married. I was fine with not getting married. I was not going to have children. Standing before you this morning never once crossed my mind when I was a young adult. Never in my life would I ever consider being a youth pastor. I didn't even be like it. I didn't like being a teenager. Why in the world would I want to minister to them, right? And if you would have said years ago that you know what, Tracy, you're actually going to be an interim pastor for a while, I would have laughed, because that was so far out of my plans and my control. That would have never happened. I would never do something crazy like that. I was actually one of those guys, and Heather can attest to it. She has her stories of when we first started dating. I was one of those guys that my eyes were always to the ground. If I didn't know you, I didn't really want to know you. I was good. My plans were good. Heather didn't even know I knew her name or anything for the first couple of dates we had, because I just wouldn't talk. But that's the way I was. I had my plans. I had control. I thought I was in control. My plans are set. My control is in my back pocket. I'm good to go. But God has other plans. God had other plans. They weren't my plans, believe me. Standing before you this morning was not in my plans, but they were in his. Zacharias never really understood that long-range implication of what God was doing. That's why he questioned it, because he didn't see, he didn't have the eyes and the mindset to look forward at long-range implications of what's going on. He was blinded by his current life, by his job, by his ministry, and by his age. He was blinded by those things. He couldn't see past those things because that's what was in front of him. And I get that. I do. I understand. Whereas I probably would have been in the same place as him. I'm not trying to belittle him at all. I would be there right with him, because I'm one of those people that if I'm not careful, I'll fall into that. That what's in front of me is the most important, and looking long range is not so important. I think sometimes that my current life, my current job, my family, ministry, even my age, that's what's most important to me right now. We need to stop that. We need to be able to look forward. We need to be able to look past that sometimes. And that moves us into the second part. Actually, God's plans. In verses 13 through 22, let me read these to you, because I think these are important. This is where things get interesting for Zechariah's life. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid." Angel's always saying that for some reason, right? "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you're to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will never he is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to the children and disobedient to the wisdom of the righteousness, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, and here we go. "How can I be sure of this?" He's sitting there talking to an angel. "How can I be assured of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." Good save, by the way. He didn't call his wife old, right? Good save. Then the angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." God had plans. He sent an angel. And not just any angel here. He sends Gabriel. And Gabriel speaks to really only three people in Scripture. Now, it might be more that are not named, but three that are named: Daniel, Zechariah, and then Mary. He is the special messenger of God, and he's bringing some info. Check out the information that he lays down in front of Zechariah. First of all, Elizabeth will bear a son. He is to be named John. He will cause joy and gladness. Many will rejoice of his birth. He will be great before the Lord. He is not to drink strong drink or any wine or anything like that. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even in the mother's womb. He will turn many in Israel back to God. He will go before the Messiah in spirit and power of Elijah. He will turn the hearts of fathers to their children. He will turn the disobedient to the wisdom of the just. He will make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Now, this is a lot of information. All that I just gave you, that's all that information that Zechariah just got. It's the pregnancy news. It's the gender reveal. It's a birth announcement. It's the naming. It's the upbringing. It's the career. And it's all rolled out into one piece of Scripture. Wow, right? Why doesn't God give me this type of directions, right? He wasn't even this specific to Mary and Joseph. That's how specific he was to Zechariah. And Zechariah still stood there and said, "You know, I'm kind of old. you sure you got the right guy here? See, this brings me, this is like disbelief for him. Like surely you're not talking to me. You can't be talking to me. I'm old. My wife is old. We've been barren all these years. And now we're going to have a child, and not just any child, but it's going to fulfill all that? Really? All this talk about a child. And we now know that it's John the Baptist. And he throws out that excuse. I'm old. I'm just old. Which translates into I have my own plans. I have my own plans. I have control. All is good. Which loosely translates into what in the world will tomorrow bring? Really? Really, this is happening? And then you go on into Matthew. Matthew, a very familiar verse. You don't have to turn there, but Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 34, it talks about that tomorrow, right? So do not worry saying, what shall I eat or what shall I drink or what shall I wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. Because see, that's where our plans and our control comes into conflict. Don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow we worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble on its own. Stop thinking of you being in control. Let's seek God first is what they're saying here. Because you see, that's where our problem lies all too often is tomorrow. Tomorrow. How am I going to deal with that? What am I going to do tomorrow? Or you know today is one of the most stressful days for somebody in the workforce. Why? You got to go back to work tomorrow. You're worrying about it. Are my plans going to work out? Am I going to be in control of everything? That's where we fall down all too often when we're moving forward. So how do I do that, though? How do I look to God instead of my own plans? How do I do that? The answer is actually right. Hopefully you have one somewhere near you, but it's right there with you. First of all, you search it out in God's Word. That's why He gave us His words. For this very reason this morning that we're able to read the Scripture and move through the Scripture and understand that even when we think the best plans are laid out in front of us because we put them there, because that guarantees me no, it doesn't. No, that's why He gave us this word that even through our difficulties, even through our messed up plans, God can still move if we just look it to Him. So we search that out in God's Word. Search it out in prayer. Stop sometimes long enough and have that conversation with God. Just like Zechariah was having a conversation with Gabriel here, have that conversation with God. Talk to Him about that. And then search it out with godly friends and family. Somebody that can counsel you. Somebody that can try to point you in the right direction. That can remind you of things. That can show you things. That can remind you that you remember when God moves in such a way. That's what your friends and family are there for. Your godly friends and family to help you move through these things. And then the hard part comes in. Listening and trusting. Trusting that His plans are better. Trusting that even though it's going to be hard, even though it's going to be difficult, even though it's going to get uncomfortable, even though I completely don't understand the roadmap that's in front of me, you know what, God, I'm going to trust You. I have to. I need to. As we finish up this morning, the mistake we sometimes make is thinking that God needs us. That's the mistake that Zechariah made here. And so what happened? he was muted. He couldn't speak another word until John was born. All too often, we think that God needs us. Let me make this as plain as I can this morning. If you're not going to search out God's plan, if you're not going to search it out in his word and prayer, in your friends and godly family members, if you're not going to just stop long enough and listen and trust him, he doesn't need you to finish the plans. Stop thinking he does. He's going to continue to move. But here's the awesome part. He wants you to. He wants you to be part of it. He knows that you need to be a part of it. He muted Zechariah, and he still completed his plans. Zechariah couldn't say a thing about what the angel had said to him. He couldn't tell Elizabeth any of this. He couldn't speak. But God still moved. God still did what he needed to do. Let him use you is what we get out of this. If you don't get anything else, get that. Let him use you. Let him use you. Give up your plans. Give your life to him. Here's the hard one. Give up your control. The control that you think. Cut those strings. Cut those strings and see what God wants to do. See where God will take you. God will take you to places you never thought you'd be. He really will. I've seen it in my own life. As we finish up today, if you will, close your eyes, bow your heads right where you sit, right where you are. Because like I said earlier, one of those parts is actually having that conversation with him. Man, I wish I could stress to you more how important that is. Having that conversation with God. I'm not going to pretend to know where you are this morning. I'm not going to pretend to know everything about your life, your family, your job. I'm not going to sit here and pretend I know about your tomorrow. I don't. But God does. And God has a plan for you. If you have never accepted him as your Savior, you don't know what I'm talking about this morning, about these plans. I encourage you to see me, see Brother Bill before you leave today. Let us have a talk with you about the plans that God has for you. But if you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, guess what? He has plans for you. He does. He has plans for you. Great plans. When we are sitting here trying to do our ordinary lives with our ordinary jobs and our ordinary families, he wants to do something extraordinary. Let him. But you're going to have to stop long enough to listen and long enough to have that conversation with him. But he has great plans for you. We do the ordinary. He does the extraordinary. As you sit there, have that conversation with him. The altar is open, but right where you're sitting, you can have that conversation with him. Talk to him about where he's leading you, what he wants you to do, and then listen. Open your eyes, even if it means us getting a little uncomfortable. And unfortunately, I'm here to tell you, when we're doing his work, doing his will, walking his way, guess what? Yeah, it's going to get uncomfortable sometimes. It's all right. It helps us to grow. It helps us to move further than we ever thought possible. Don't put excuses out there. He knows every one of them. Let him lead and guide you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for today. Father, we thank you for this appointed time that you've given us today, that we were able to come together as family and have this time to have a conversation about control, about our plans and how they don't even come close to stacking up to what you have in store. Father, you do great things. And my prayer today is that you do them through us. That we open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds to those great things and then move forward with them. Step by step. Even if it's a small step at first, it's still a step, Father. Lead us and guide us in that. Lead us and guide us into that next step. And just one step, Father. And then the next step. And the next one. And the next one after that. Lead us in that, Father. Father, if there's one here today that doesn't know you and hasn't given their life to you yet, Father, I pray that you give that urging to them, that you give that desire inside their hearts to talk to somebody about that can help them, that can lead them. Father, we ask that. And finally, we ask this morning that as we leave out today, as we go about our lives, as we go about our jobs, our family, that we won't let that stuff blind us to the long-range kingdom goals that you have for us. Lead us and guide us in that, Father. And we ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. If you'll please stand, let's sing a song.
Jesus, I surrender all to Him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. I surrender all.
Johnny makes his way up. I do have one announcement that I wanted to make sure that I made. There's actually a basket back there in the back that my loving wife made and a note and everything. Thank you so much for remembering. I didn't. And so I was scrambling around this morning, had Miss Sheila helping me out this morning. But Heather, I love her. But what is that basket? It's about our youth fundraiser that we're doing this morning, our youth love offering that we're doing this morning. So what's that for? It's for our Christmas box dinners for the needy in our community. It's Maple Springs using what God has given us. He's given us the ability to put boxes together. He's given us the ability to find the families that need help. We already have 20 families through the Seagrove School with Backpack Pals that are already signed up. We're going to be going over to the food pantry for the next couple Saturdays to take down information for those folks. We're looking at giving out 50 boxes of Christmas dinner. Here's the awesome part of this that we're doing. When we put these boxes together, I don't know if you remember from last year or not, but it's everything that you need for a Christmas dinner, all the way from the ham to the apple pie afterwards, because you got to have pie after a dinner, right? So it has everything included, and it's really easily cooked. The ham is already cooked, actually. We're getting pre-cooked ham, but everything else is simply cooked in the kitchen with the idea of, you know, what we love at the Marsh household is everybody coming to kitchen together and cooking. All the way from Ben, Blake, Mom, Heather, and myself, we all had a part in cooking the Thanksgiving dinner. Why not help families with that at Christmas time? And that's what these boxes are. I've already talked to, we're doing everything local from Fresh Cuts. He's going to help purchase everything at a much better price than you find on the shelf, so I appreciate that. And plus, we get to put our money into a local company as well. So that's a win there as well. But that's what that's for. That's what that basket's back there for. Every bit of it will go to the boxes. Nothing else, nothing goes to the youth or anything like that. It all 100% goes to those boxes for the needy for Christmas. And we'll be handing them out the week before Christmas. So let me go ahead and thank you in advance for that. But that's what the basket back there is for. You'll see it. It's on the opposite side of our normal giving bucket. So with that said, let me hand everything over. Donnie's hiding. There's Donnie. He'll take it from here.
Sorry, I'm still drooling thinking about 25 pounds of turkey. I'm like, oh my good. I would like to control that. Oh, thank you all so much for coming today. And thank you for being here and allowing me to come up and talk to you for a few minutes. As far as our weekly opportunities, first of all, I want to take the opportunity to thank Johnny and Lisa Moxie for the Christmas decorations. I wish my house, yeah, they're very beautiful. I wish I could go home and then come back and my house be decorated. Just like, it'd be awesome. That'd be a bingo. But they did a really good job, and so we thank them. And thank you to all the men who came and blew the leaves. Thank you very much for that, and thank you for your hard work. It looks good outside. Don't forget the food pantry and the things you're supposed to be. The food pantry is still back there as far as where you can give. Don't forget that next Saturday is our church-wide Christmas party. So please try to remember to come and bring a $10 gift. And also, if something happens and you decide not to come, or if you already know that you're not going to be here, if you could let Mama Judy or Sandra know in advance, today would be a good day to let them know, because they got to pay for it and get it ready. So if you're not able to come, if you could just let them know, we sure would appreciate it. Or if you want to come, then today would be a good day to let them know, okay? So remember that, $10 gift, unless you're going to give it to me, it's $20. Just kidding. No, I'm not really. Ladies for Christ, oh, and that Christmas party will be at Camp Caraway, okay? So don't forget that. Ladies for Christ, Christmas party, December the 8th. Please come to that. And also don't forget that next Sunday, and I'm excited about this, next Sunday, on the 5th, we're starting Sunday school again. So Sunday school starts at 9:45 and worship service is at 11 o'clock. So please remember that, and I hope you'll be able to come. And also, don't forget, there is a a place back there where you can donate for Backpack Pals. If you've signed up for it, or if you want to give, there's a place back there where you can give for Backpack Pals. So please try to help with that if you can. I agree with Tracy and all this giving and families in need. There's many of them in our community, many more than we know of. And so I want you to remember that, if you will. As far as prayer requests, I want you to remember a 10-year-old named Levi. A tree fell on him while he was cutting woods with his dad and grandpa, and specifically pray for his lungs. And I've been praying for him, and I pray that you will do also. Also, Miss Canary wants us to pray for her brother, Bobby, who is struggling with cancer and is going to have surgery soon. Pray for her sister-in-law, Shirley, who's having multiple health problems. So remember those, if you will. And we sure would appreciate it. Also, this week is the IMB's Week of Prayer for International International Missions. So if you want to get you a pamphlet to see what to pray for specifically, that would be a great idea. But it's a good time to remember those who are out there in the field working for the Lord and harvesting for the Lord. And I pray that we would be remembering them in prayer. Also pray for those who aren't able to be with us. You can look around and see where people might be sick or they might be somewhere else. Please remember them in your prayers. As far as giving goes, next Sunday we begin our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. So be praying about what God wants you to give, and be praying that God will bless your gift and use it for his glory, and I know and I'm sure he will. Also, we're fixing to watch a video. It's called A Life Given, and I hope you will watch.
For 175 years, God has given life to this organization. He has called us to go. Thousands have answered that call, and Southern Baptists have joined together to send them. From every walk of life, from every part of our country, they boarded ships and planes, leaving behind all that was comfortable, predictable, safe and secure. All to go and share the good news of Jesus Christ. Into deserts and jungles, across mountains and seas, they planted their lives preaching Christ crucified. Many completed their service and came back to their homeland, but some did not. Some would perish on the field. They would starve, become ill, or be struck down on distant and dangerous roads to present the gospel. And some would be struck down for simply preaching the good news of Christ. In moments of extreme violence, many would choose to stay in danger to bring peace to those in the midst of chaos. Those are dark days for all of us, when we lose our brothers and sisters, when we feel the very real sting of death. On those days, we all ask, is it worth it? Is it worth the high price, the ultimate price? Etched on the hearts of missionaries throughout time are words like these. My life is of no value. My aim is to finish the race. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. So we take up our cross to be living sacrifices. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. These lives were not lost. These lives were given. We may never know the full impact these missionaries have given on this side of eternity, but some stories we do know. Stories of God pouring out His Spirit on tribes and nations because missionaries modeled the one true sacrifice. Generations forever altered. Life is a gift. How will you use the life you've been given?
You know, Tracy spoke this morning on control, and he spoke about plans. And the thing is that these people who passed, they had plans. Their families had plans for them, you know, but God had a bigger plan, and that plan was to sacrifice their lives for the sake of the gospel. And when we give and when we pray for them, we're affirming that it was worth it, and that we're affirming the fact that we support them and we love them and we haven't forgotten. And so that is very important that we remember that as we go about giving to Lottie Moon, that we support those people who are giving their lives for the gospel. So we do need to remember that. Today, remember, the youth are taking up that special offering for Christmas meals. And be praying for those families in advance who are going to receive those meals that will come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. I was asked to read this note, and it's from Bill and Sheila, and I want to read it to you. It says, "Dear Maple Springs family, this weekend marks the third anniversary of our arrival at Maple Springs. The past 3 years have been unique and challenging. We have cherished being able to love, laugh, and at times shed tears with you. Though our biological families have been far from us, many of you have made us part of your family. My wife and I treasure the relationships and close bonds we have made here at Maple Springs and just want to let you know how much you mean to us. As a small token of our appreciation," ooh, I'm beginning to like how this sounds. "As a small token of our appreciation, Sheila has made cupcakes for each person here today." For those of you at home, I'll eat yours. It's okay. We'll mail them to you. "Please stop in the foyer on your way out and get a cupcake from us as our way of saying how much we love and value you, as well as how much we look forward to the future God has for Maple Springs. In Christ, Pastor Bill Simpson." And Bill, we love you and Sheila. And believe me, we are very thankful for you as well and very grateful for the love that you've shown us. So with that, so we can go get our cupcakes, let's go ahead and close in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we love you so much. Father, we thank you so much that you love us, God, that you sent your son Jesus to die on a cross, dear God, Lord, that we might be saved, dear Father. Lord God, I thank you, Lord, that we are a part of a family of God, Lord, that reaches throughout generations, that reaches out through countries and nations and tribes. God, we thank you and praise you, God, that you adopted us and made us children of God. Lord, we're not worthy, but Lord, we love you and praise you for that, dear God. And Lord, Father, I do pray, God, that you bless the missionaries out there who are willing to sacrifice, or willing to die for the gospel, and to die so that people would come to know you as their Lord and Savior, God. Lord, I pray that we would be willing to sacrifice our money, our time, even our reputations, God, for the gospel of Christ. Lord God, I pray, Lord, that you would use us for your glory. And God, help us that we might serve you all in all, each and every day. God, we love you. We thank you and praise you, God. And Lord, I pray you bless our pastor and his wife, dear God, and his family. God, thank you for what they mean to us, dear God. We love you. We thank you and praise you, God. And I pray you be with us this week. Help us, God, that we would increase the kingdom. And God, that we would show your hand at work. We love you, thank you, and praise you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for coming.